So this is what we have been discussing. Auditing is more about studying a situation. You analyze the risks involved at each particular level. You evaluate the information obtained and you apply the knowledge that you already have to the situation that is presented before you. Okay, much of the auditing paper is really to do with auditing or external audit services, but there are so many various issues that you also need to have knowledge of when you're doing this paper. Things like internal auditing, I think these days it is an integral part of that paper. You will always find a question on internal audit. Social and environmental audits. We have forensic audits. I think they also appear once in a while or every sitting also. Prospective financial audit. This is to do with prospective financial information. If you have looked at past papers, I'm sure you have seen some of these papers. Corporate social responsibility audit. But it also includes other issues like corporate governance, IT, and many other issues. So what I said, whatever you have studied within your course up to this level should somehow come in relevant for this paper. Internal service, the auditing service, has the goal of improving information or context of information so that decision makers can make more informed and presumably better decisions. When, for example, you carry out an audit, there are so many people who are relying on the report that you are preparing. We have tax people, we have shareholders, and so many other people who need this kind of information. So they'll be making decisions based on the information that is presented in the financial statements. And you'll agree with me that sometimes management who will have prepared these financial statements may not be the best placed people to give unbiased information, because they also give information which is beneficial to themselves. For example, if their payment depends on performance, then they'll try as much as possible to ensure that the performance is perfect. So that is where auditors come in, review this information, and ensure that what is presented here, it is about true and fair view. You all understand the concept of true and fair view, right? Yes, we don't need perfect things, but at least they need to be. That is what we are saying, that assurance services provide independent and professional opinions that reduce information risk from incorrect information. That is what we have discussed. Assurance engagements, as a rule, are designed to test historical financial information. That is, you are carrying out an audit of things which have happened in the past. It is more of a post-mortem. Right after the patient has died, you go back and see what killed that patient. So auditing is more or less the same as that. You have to review historical information. Consulting services are not considered as assurance because an accountant generally uses professional knowledge to make recommendations for a future event or procedure, such as design of an information system or an accounting control system. But the examination paper that you're going to sit for don't preclude something to do with the requirement for you to give some professional advice, which may be more of a consulting nature. So you need to put that into consideration. So we also have agreed upon procedures. This is as per ISRS 4400. These are also not assurance because we don't give a conclusion, but you can still be examined on the same. This also goes for compilation engagements. I hope you all understand all these terms that we're talking about. Internal audit serves an important role in fraud prevention, and that is one of the reasons why it is also an integral part of this paper. So what is the relevance of auditing and other assurance services? Auditing, an organization that has an audit carried out regularly will keep the management on their toes. So it helps in maintaining the integrity and for management to ensure that they attain the specific goals of the organization by measuring overall performance and productivity.
From financial statements presenting a reliable health picture to the stakeholders. This is the issue we talked about earlier, that yes, management are not in the best position to give a reliable picture because they'll give information which is suitable to themselves. So the auditor comes in to ensure that the information presented is reliable. It reduces risk and cost of capital. Once we have fewer errors and mistakes in the and frauds, then the cost of capital is also lowered. It can help us know the value of an organization's shares. It offers up-to-date information on techniques, rules, and regulations. So, as I said earlier, an auditor is expected to be up-to-date on various issues concerning accounting and auditing. So, you are supposed to, or you are expected to pass this information on to your clients to ensure that what they are presenting is up to date. It also improves your powers of observation as an individual. Well, when you do auditing, you going through these various scenarios, for example, can help you pick issues within an organization. So once you're going to do an organizational audit, then chances are that you'll have a chat with management, you'll discuss various issues. So you are supposed to pick out the important issues, pick out the risk areas, pick out their strong points in case you are planning to rely on them, such as internal controls. So it generally helps you there. So I think the trick some people use is that you first look at the requirements at the bottom of the question and ensure that as you read through the scenario, you could pick a few of the issues that may be required at the end of the question. And you pick whatever is relevant to your answer. So, as that one says there, the trick is to first read the requirement before reading the scenario, so that as you read through the scenario, you are able to isolate issues that you think are relevant to your answer. The other issues one would look at are things which are conspicuously absent, yet would be expected in a given setting. For example, if we look at terms of corporate governance and they're asking you to look at risk, and then you are looking at this company which in the scenario nothing is mentioned about having, for example, a board of directors, then you should be able to say, why isn't there a board of directors in this company if you are looking at that kind of risk. As we said earlier, use the correct form of the document requested. If they need a report, try to put the report. If it is a memo, put a memo. If they're asking you to write a letter, write a letter. I take it that you have all learned how to write letters, for example. So Some of those issues earn you free marks. You may get 1 or 2 marks just by using the correct form of the document that is required. You need to identify the correct recipient of the report that you're trying to prepare and address it accordingly. If they're telling you you're writing, for example, to the managing director, it may be different from how maybe if you are a supervisor or a manager, they're asking you to write to the engagement partner. So use the correct form of identify the correct recipient and you write accordingly. So you need to pay attention to the verbs used in the question. For example, if they tell you to discuss, I think if you are discussing, then you are looking, for example, at two different issues, maybe to come up with the best course of action for something. If they are telling you to elaborate, you also try to elaborate, explain in detail about what is being asked of you. A multi-topic approach is essential for professional papers, especially for scenario-based questions. So, in a scenario-based question, chances are that you are going to be examined on so many various topics. We shall have risk, we shall have planning, we shall have audit evidence, we shall have conclusions. Chances are that you will have so very many topics in one question. So don't try to spot. Make sure that you are knowledgeable on all areas of the paper that you're going to sit for, or the subject. Some questions may require calculations such as ratios, materiality, analytical reviews for audit planning or completion. So, in many cases, when you get some figures within the auditing paper, chances are that they require you to calculate something, either the ratios or materiality or something. So, it may not specifically, the question may not specifically ask you for those ratios, but based on the requirement of the question, you need to gauge, and you also need to exercise professional judgment and see whether you need to calculate these ratios. So that may earn you a few marks, but more importantly, the information you use the ratios for will be even more important than computing the ratios themselves. So don't compute them and leave them hanging. Use them. So the overall aim is to enable the learner consolidate knowledge and understanding of the process of executing and finalizing an audit and other assurance engagements in compliance with international standards on auditing and the Ugandan regulatory framework. So at the end of the course, you should be able to advise on regulatory, professional, and ethical issues relevant to those carrying out audits or other assurance services. So these are the very things that they're going to examine you on. Can you advise an entrepreneur? Can you advise your boss if you're working in an audit firm? Ideally, the paper probably assumes that you're going to work at least around the auditing environment. You may not be an auditor yourself, but at least you are being audited or somewhere in the audit environment. So analyze risk assessment and planning procedures. Risk assessment is a very big part of the audit process. So make sure that you're very conversant with risk assessment. It is not very easy to complete an audit paper without something to do with risk. So, risk assessment. What are the planning procedures? I'm quite sure you are all very conversant with planning. So, prepare audit working papers. Yes, sometimes you are advised or you are requested to come up with probably audit procedures, maybe for your juniors or other people, depending on a given set of circumstances. So you need to know audit objectives, what is expected, if you are advising people on which particular tests they should be carrying out in any particular area, please don't fail to do that. So, at the end of the day, as they are saying, the aim is to prepare the audit working papers and any other documents of tests performed to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence to come up with an audit conclusion. So, discuss the issues associated with group audits. If you start reading your scenario and yes, they are talking about 2-3 companies under similar management, or one has shares in the other, then chances are that they are going to ask you something about group audits. So please be knowledgeable about the group audits. Remember your financial accounting. Chances are that it will come in handy when you are answering such a question, and it will help you earn marks. So you need to know how to prepare working papers, documenting the audit finalization procedures performed, and to use any evidence gathered to form an audit opinion. So, ethics is becoming quite critical all over the accounting landscape. So, ensure you are knowledgeable about ethical issues, those facing auditors, and other ethical issues, to avoid scenarios where you may be taken, for example, to the disciplinary committee of council to answer some unethical issues. You need to be able to advise on internal audit engagements and management of the internal audit function. As I said, internal auditing is also now a critical part of this paper, and you need to know about the auditing from all angles, because the questions are asked in all manner of ways. You need to know about forensic audits and investigations, which are also very important given the environment that we live in. But you also need to know the performance of other assurance engagements, not only audits. You can have review engagements, compilation engagements, and many others. You need to demonstrate an understanding of the management of an audit firm. I think all this knowledge is available within your study pack for paper 17. And as we said earlier, we also need to know how to discuss emerging issues in auditing. So if you read in a magazine or a paper or wherever it may be, and there are new issues coming up, chances are even that if there is a new issue that has come up, you may be examined upon that in the coming sitting. So please be informed. So when you're undertaking this paper, you also need to understand laws and regulations that affect an audit. When you're working on a client, you need to understand whatever laws there are that govern this client. Of course, the Companies Act is an obvious one if you are doing a company audit. But if they are working on environmental issues, or for example, if their activities affect the environment, like agriculture and things of that nature, chances are that the environment will also be a critical part, or the environmental laws will be a critical part of this client. So try to appreciate your client and know exactly which laws and regulations may affect that client. If they affect the client, then they will definitely affect you as an auditor as well. You need to appreciate relevant responsibilities of both management and the auditors as far as an audit is concerned. When I looked at some of the examiner's reports for papers which were recently done, these were some of the comments I got. So, what were the issues? Students failing to answer specific question requirements. The keywords were probably ignored. Not applying knowledge to question scenarios, but reproducing the contents of the scenario. Don't just reproduce the content of the scenario. Use the knowledge in the scenario to come up with the answer that is required. Giving few answers as compared to allocated marks per question. As I said earlier, for example, if you see that something has 5 marks, don't go and write 5 full pages of answers in that case. Get the number of marks and know that they directly affect the answers that you're supposed to give. So, marks are very important. So, try as much as possible to identify as many risks as possible. As I told you earlier, if a question is probably 14 marks, for example, they have asked you for risks maybe being faced by a particular client from the scenario. If you see 14, chances are that you need to probably produce 7 or more points to earn full marks. So don't identify 2 or 3 risks and you think you're going to earn full marks. Some people identified the risks but never explained in relation. Conclusion, please prepare adequately and read widely.